Hi, thank you very much for inviting me here, Chaya, and all of you at the Porsche studio. I will run you through this presentation through some images that come up in Kabir's poetry around the idea of city. And as you know, Kabir was very much a man of the city. He belonged to Varanasi, and his poetry abounds in images of Sheher, Nagar, of steps, of palaces, of garh, of fort, of rivers, of ghats, of the marketplace. So these are the images I'm going to take you through to kind of create a poetic space that hopefully will open up for you to imagine the cities that Kabir imagined in his poetry. And I'm quite intrigued to hear about the title of your studio, which is Porsche, which Chaya told me something about and which I read about, which said Porsche is those parts of the architectural plan that are invisible, but make the experience of the visible possible. Those not immediately visible to the eye, but are important to create the experience of the visible. And interestingly also, the Porsche is the darker part of the architectural plan. So in a sense, to me, both these ideas resonate with a Kabirian gaze or a Sufi gaze, because the Sufi will ask you always to go beyond the Zahir to connect with the Batin, the Zahir being the manifest, the tangible, to the hidden meaning or truth that glimmers beneath the surface, which is the Batin. Or Kabir might put it as the Sagun and the Nirgun. And also the darker part of the architectural plan is often that aspect of our self that is the shadow self, that is not visible sometimes even to us, that the bhakta or the Sufi will insist that we get in touch with. So I'm going to start here with an image from a Kabir song that really inspired us, which said, Thara rang mehel mein, ajab shahar mein, aja re hansa bhai, nirgun raja pe sirgun sej bichhai. And I'm going to try and share also in text form all the poems that I share with you here today, because sometimes it's good to get the text as well, so that, you know, the poem as it comes out of my mouth doesn't just disappear before you could grasp it. So give me a moment. So here's the poem. Thara rang mehel mein, ajab shahar mein, aja re hansa bhai, nirgun raja pe sirgun sej bichhai. Come swan, Kabir is referring to us as hansas, our swan soul, and inviting it into this Ranmahal, this palace of delight, what he calls an ajab shahar, a wondrous city, or a strange, unfamiliar city, where an invisible king reclines on a bed of form. And why ajab? Why strange? Why unfamiliar? Because we may think we know who we are. This is my name, this is my religion, this is my caste, this is my nation, this is my hometown, but Kabir will push you. He will say, who are you truly? Beneath all those labels and narratives that you tell yourself about yourself and you tell the world about yourself, who are you really? He will ask you to penetrate deeper. And you may find yourself in an uncharted land if you respond to this call. An ajab shahar with no GPS. And I want to quote a very Must poet called Dr. Seuss, who says, "You will come to a place where the streets are not marked. Some windows are lighted, but mostly they are darked. A place you could sprain both your elbow and chin. Do you dare to stay out? Do you dare to go in?" So this invitation into the city of the self can bring us to this place where alien streets signal a town we have lived in but never really set out to explore. There are many insights. Rivers course up and down. In a pool of clear still waters, a lotus blooms. A bee hovers. Fish climb trees. There is a king, but we cannot see him. He reclines resplendent in a palace of 10 gates and a pillar of air. Jogis patrol the gates. A slippery path wends upwards towards a peak. Bands of 5, sometimes 25 dacoits lie in wait to ambush us in daylight. There are many strangers to acquaint ourselves with here. The mind, the heart, senses, breath, awareness. And to catch a glimpse of that invisible Raja, that Nirgun Raja of this city of the self, may require a trust in reversals, in going beyond that which is apprehended merely through the rational intellect, beyond the sensorial and the sensical. So Kabir says, "Nirgun aage sagun nache, baje soham tur, chele ke paon guru lage, yahi achambhapur." Form dances before the formless. The drums of oneness resound. At the feet of a disciple, the guru bows. A miraculous turnaround. So, in coming to know ourselves, Kabir promises there may be miraculous turnarounds. And maybe then we will understand why he calls it also an ajab sheher, not just unfamiliar, but wondrous. So this is the full translation of the song, Rang Mehel. "Ah yes, my friend, God doesn't dwell in those outward shrines, striking those temple bells. What do you crave? Ah yes, the path to the limitless has no signposts or lights. If you have no guide, what can I say? This cup brims with nectar. It is for everybody. Why favor some and disfavor others? Think about it. Catch the sign," Kabir says, "in the sign." So what are the hints? What are the signs he gives us? Where does the self lie? Where this city? He says, "Jat hamari atma, pran hamara naam, alak hamara ishta hai, or gagan hamara gam. My caste is my soul, my breath the name I go by. Invisible is my deity, my hometown is the sky." So this is another image that has come up, which is that of the city of the sky. And essentially what Kabir is doing is he's taking away the ground from underneath our feet, which is the ground of duality, which is how we anchor ourselves and create our sense of identity or self. And he is taking us into a place of groundlessness. And maybe this is where we encounter the Nirgun Raja. In another poem, Kabir says, "Un muni sun man laga, gagan hi pahuncha jaye, chand bihuna chandni, alak niranjan rai." Absorbed, still, unwavering, my mind climbs to the firmament. A glow in a moonless light I see, the unseen, unmarred king. This is the self Kabir is inviting us to connect with. And repeatedly, the image will come up of the sky, that glorious metaphor for unboundedness, our own capacity for limitlessness, that which is uncontained in us. And importantly, this intangible can only be grasped or experienced through the tangible. So where is the sky? It's in the body. It is in the contained. And it is through the contained that the uncontained can be glimpsed. And I guess this is why the body becomes sacred for Kabir. And this is another image of the city in Kabir's poetry, which is that of the body as the holy city, because it is only through the body that we connect with something that goes beyond it. So here he will say, Man Mathura Dil Dwarka Kaya Kashi Jan Das Dware Ka Pinjara Yame Jyot Pichhan. Mind Mathura, heart Dwarka, your body a holy city. In a cage of 10 doors, find here itself, luminosity. So, Kabir, of course, is being iconoclastic here because the subtle iconoclasm in this poem, the subtle point of attack is the holiest of holy cities, which is Varanasi, which is from where he is, a famous pilgrimage town, a venerated city, a citadel of Brahminical knowledge and practice. And Kabir will insist that the true site for pilgrimage is the Kaya Nagari. This is the site of possibility, of experience, of love. Ghat mahi avaghat paiya, avaghat mahi ghat. Kahe Kabir paracha bhaya, guru dikhai baat. In this body, a perilous path. In this peril, the goal. I know it now, says Kabir. My guru showed me this road. So I'd like us to begin this journey into this holy city, this Kaya Kashi, this Ajab Sheher that Kabir is inviting us into, so that we may begin to understand the self, led on by our guide, Kabir. So the first image that comes often in Kabir's poetry, of course, is this as a Rang Mahal, a palace with 10 gates, the gates being the orifices of our body, through which we transact in sensory ways with the world. And sometimes in Kabir's poems, you will find the gates of the city being patrolled by yogis, which I like to think of as sentinels of mindfulness, because they stop and screen all visitors who seek entry. And who are these visitors? Impressions, stimulations, nourishments, intoxicants, pleasures, ideas. So Kabir will say, be vigilant. Who is entering this Kaya Nagari? Often the city is completely unguarded, actually. And Kabir will say, who's in charge here? Why is it that in broad daylight, the five dacoits, the bandits of our senses, loot us at will? In this city, we come upon ghats. As you know, the river steps leading down to the river in Varanasi are called the ghats. And on these ghats, all of samsara unfolds. Families bathe, washermen beat their clothes, boys play cricket. Sandalwood paste is ground as sadhus heckle tourists, and the dead are sent off to their fiery and subsequently watery graves. And all the while, the river flows on. Its waters signal time. They signal the Bhavasagar, all our sensory flows. And Kabir fashions this body as having several ghats, several step banks from which we transact with these sensory flows, these waters. But he will say, come to the Avghat Ghat. Who comes to the Avghat Ghat? Ghate pani sab bhare, Avghat bhare na koi. Avghat ghat kabir ka bhare so nirmal hoi. So he says they all fill water at the river steps, but no one from that perilous bank where Kabir is drawn. Those who draw water there are cleansed. So evidently the ishara here is yogic, because the Avaghat Ghat is to be found here in the Sahasrara Chakra, from where the yogi drinks. Having made that journey from the Muladhar Chakra, which is the baser me-first instinct, to upwards, climbing up to that perilous ghat, that open-hearted, other-centric, expansive Avaghat Ghat. But it's a very difficult, difficult climb. And here in the city, in this Kaya Nagriya, the Dhobi Ghats, the Lohar Ki Dukan, the Julahas, Pit and Loom, here's where we meet with ironsmiths and potters, weavers and washermen, dyers and dhobis, all working with their hands and bodies, practicing their trade, engaging with the material realities of their trade, clay, cloth, mud, dye, lead, iron. These are the gurus, the true source of wisdom. In Kabir's poetry, very often they will speak to you, Mati kahe kumhar se, ya lakdi kahe lohar se. They have incredible wisdom. So the potter, the weaver will listen and learn from material. And the sensual, the material, the located and this embodied is sacred. It is the path to the invisible. And always I feel in Kabir, the invisible or the alak is pointed to, but from the place of luck. So he is not privileging the intangible at the expense of the tangible. He is always showing us the movement actually between kath akath, spoken, unspoken, luck, alak, seen and unseen, between the embodied and the disembodied. And then we arrive into the bazaar, which is a big image in Kabir's poetry. The bazaar unfolds as an image for this lifetime itself on earth, in which we get an opportunity to buy something, to sell something, to give, to take, to receive, to offer an exchange. And what does Kabir see when he casts a gaze upon the markets of this world? He sees untruths selling like hotcakes and no buyers for the truth. So let me share some poetry here with you. So here Kabir says, Saach koi na patiai, jhoothe jag patiai, gali gali gauras phire, madira baith bikai. There are no takers for the true, the fake sells like gold. Milk cans roll from door to door, while liquor sits still and gets sold. He will say, Ram naam ki loot hai, loot sake to loot, ant mein pachtayega jab pran jayega chhoot. There is a bumper discount sale available of Ram's name, available fulsomely at all times. But nobody is really interested in that kind of bargain. Ram's name is up for grabs. Plunder this booty if you can. You may regret the chance you lost when your last breath is gone. And often the Ram Naam, the name, gleams like a pearl of contemplation, because one big image in Kabir's poetry is the jeweler's heart, the Johri Bazaar. Lagyo ghat bhitar, he will say. And what are these jewels? The jewels of our breath, the jewels of this present moment, easy and fulsomely available, but no one cares for it till they are gone. So here he says, Heera pada bazaar mein khalak ulanghya jaye, jab aave koi parkhi, mehenge mol bikai. A jewel languishes in the market, no one gives it a glance. When a true connoisseur comes along, it fetches a priceless sum. So repeatedly in these images of the city market, Kabir will ask us, Bhavra, tune kya kamaya? Govindo gayo nahi, tune kya kamayo Bhavra? Bar bar, alag alag tarike se, he will ask us, what did we truly earn in this opportunity we had to trade something in the market of this world? What wealth? We came, we scrambled, we competed, we grabbed, we looted, we rioted, and we left, having hoarded and accumulated a lot of stuff that we couldn't take along. So Kabir says, Kabir so dhan sanchiye, jo aage ko hoy, sis chadhaye portali, le jaat dekha na koi. Garner that kind of wealth you can take along when you go. Ever saw a dead man walk with a bag of belongings in tow? Which brings us to another pretty dramatic image of the city in Kabir's poetry, which is Sadho Dekho Murdon Ka Gaon, where we see a bustling, milling hubbub of people. Kabir sees dead men walking. So here he says, Sadho ye murdon ka gaon, peer mare, paigambar mari hain jinda jogi, raja mari hain, pirja mari hain, baid aur rogi, chanda mari hai, suraj mari hai dharni akasa, chauda bhuvan ke chaudhari mari hain, inho ki ka asa. नौहू मरी हैं, दसहू मरी हैं सहज अट्ठासी, तैंतीस कोटी देवता मरी हैं, बड़ी काल की बाजी. नाम अनाम अनंत रहत है, दूजा तत्व न होई, कहे कबीर सुनो भाई साधो, भटक मरो मत कोई. Look seekers, a city of corpses. Sages die, prophets die, they all die, the robust ascetics. Kings die, their subjects die, doctors die, and so do their patients. The moon dies, the sun dies, so does earth and sky. Bosses of 14 worlds die, what hope of help from them? The 9 die, the 10 die, the 88 die easy too. 33,000 gods die, snarled by death's noose. The name with no name lives on, now that's an eternal truth. Says Kabir, listen seekers, don't die just wandering about. So, we return again and again to the name, the naam, the jewel of contemplativeness, of attention, of self-awareness, as the only undying entity. Sometimes Kabir will evoke the image of death in the city as a plundered city. He will say, Kona thagwa nagariya lootal ho. He will speak of a thief that will steal into this body city. No matter all your defenses, death will find a way in. Because all things that are erected must fall or crumble. Jo chune wo dahi pade. So he will say, Kabir naubat apni दिन दस लई बजाए, ये शहर ये गलियां देखे ही छूट जाए. The drum rolls of the self beat for just 10 days. It will vanish in a flash, this city, its alleys and ways. And so cities that inspire must die with as much beauty and grace as they live. Impermanence can be envisioned at all moments in our city. And this Kabir calls dying before your death, or the art of dying. But what does that mean? One way to die before your death, using an image of the city, would be to Stop clinging to the walls. Stop building these walls, these defensive ramparts of the proud city of the self. Let them collapse. So he says, Main ke gad ko naash kiya, durjan kaadhe dur, raj piyare Ram ka nagar basa bharpur. The fort of the ego is blasted. Thieves flee to distant lands. The reign of beloved Ram begins. The city prospers and swells. So walls are very strange things. We erect them because we want to keep the thieves out. But often walls, protective walls, are keeping the thieves in. So when Kabir's Ram takes over the reins of this city, there are no walls and no fort, for he has nothing to protect and nothing to hide. When the separative walls of I crumble, scoundrels scamper for cover because their nexus with the ego is exposed. Who are they? Who are these thieves? Lust, anger, greed, attachment, pride. These are the thieves that operate behind these protective walls to keep them propped. But when these walls collapse, a true Ram Rajya begins. A way of being in this world where no territory is clung to. Because the mystic rejects the protected walled city, one that excludes, the city of Brahmins, the city of the pure, the exalted, the canonical, that practices the politics of exclusion. Kabir is in quarrel with such a city, as you know. You all know about the fact that Kabir lived all his life in Varanasi, but towards the end of his life, he dumped it and migrated to a city called Maghar. Jahan kehte the ke if you die in Varanasi, you get reborn in heaven or you gain swarg. But if you die in Maghar, you get reborn in your next life as a donkey. So evidently, Maghar is the city of the reviled, of the dispossessed, those ridiculed to a bleak karmic future. Varanasi's shadow city is Maghar, that which is treated as the other. So Kabir demands that we go there. We look within, we confront, embrace, and include that shadow self. And this idea of looking deeply within also comes up in a very beautiful image in Lalon Fakir's poetry for the city, which is Arshinagar, which is the city of mirrors, where he says, a neighbor lives, but I can't see him. You know, the act of acquainting yourself with this mysterious neighbor who lives in this city of mirrors is the act of coming to know the self, befriending the stranger within. I'd like to tell you now a story from the poetry of Sindhi Sufi called Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai, because the idea of a city with a which is plundered or whose defensive walls have collapsed resonates in Shah Latif's poetry in a very interesting way in this one particular story. So in the kingdom of Junagadh, there was a king, Raidiach, a great patron of the arts and a great lover of music. And one day, sitting in his palace, he heard the strains of a surando come wafting into his palace walls, through his walls, into his court. And he was quite entranced. So he sent his courtiers out, ke pata lagao ye kaun hai. And they came back saying, it's a wandering minstrel called Bijal. So he said, call him into the palace. Bijal arrives and the king asks Bijal to sing. In a high palace, the king, down on the ground, the bard, but the strains of his surando penetrate the palace walls, right? And when Bijal begins to play for the king goes into a trance. He is undone. transfigured. When the music ends, the king returns to the world, and deeply overwhelmed by the music, he asks Bijal to ask for anything by way of reward for playing such amazing music. And Bijal says, Nani, you won't be able to afford it, let it be. So the king's pride is tongue, and he says, you know, I'm the Raja of this land. What do you think? Ask for anything, it will be yours. And Bijal keeps saying no. When he insists, the king, Bijal finally says, okay, king, I ask for your head. The beggar entered the palace bearing his instrument. He struck up his melody and fortresses fell. Oh, Bijal, your music resounds everywhere. The cry has gone out in the city. You've asked for the king's head. The king beheads himself. The queen wails. Courtiers are stunned, and the city of Junagadh is plunged into mourning. Junagadh, in the poetic imagination of Shah Latif, is the world which is to be left behind, mourning and weeping. Bijal is the Murshid, the guru, who asks for the impossible price. The king is the disciple yearning for the truth, his body and ego self, the royal palace, the fort, where Bijal plays his instrument. And the price Bijal demands for his music is the king's head, his khudi, which blocks him from Khuda. They struck a wondrous deal, the string, the dagger, and the head. But is this all you came for, minstrel? From so far away, my head is not worthy of you, says the king. So what was the undoing of the king's ego self, his defensive, separative boundary? Music. Interestingly, Kabir also asks us to listen to the Anhadnad, an extraordinary unstruck sound, which once heard cannot be unheard. It may compel us to cut off our head. So I'd like to now share with you poetry that takes us into the place of love, into another image of the city, which is the city of the beloved, which is accessed only through a loss of self, through a cutting off the head, through a dissolution of separative walls. So let me just share something with you here. So here Kabir says, Ye to ghar hai prem ka, khala ka ghar nahi. Sheesh kaat bhoi dhare tab baithe ghar mahi. This is the house of love, my friend, not your auntie's open house. Chop off your head, place it on the floor, or else the gates are shut. This house or city, the Saiki Nagari, is a place we yearn for, a deep yearning, a deep sense of separation from this space beyond. In the poetry of Rai Das, he fashions this as Begumpur, the sorrowless city, a utopian vision of a place beyond hierarchies and violence, beyond torture and terror. Kabir speaks of it as Saiki Nagri, a space, a des, beyond both sorrow and joy, where all dualities dissolve, no sun, no moon, no wind, no water, where this fragile entity, the I, reified into our existence, into our minds, as a solid sense, positioned in the hard, solid dualities of this world. When this dissolves, collapses, gives way, the gap between self and the other dissolves, the gap between self and beloved dissolves, and the fortress collapses into emptiness. And Kabir says, Shunya gad shahar, shahar ghar basti, kaun suta, kaun jaage hai, lal hamre hum lalan ke, tan suta brahm jaage hai. Empty fort, city, home, dwelling, who's asleep and who awake. The beloved and I merge into one. The body slumbers, the spirits awake. So here we come up with another image of the city in Kabir's poetry, which is Shunyagar Sheher, which to me has very clear Buddhist resonances, because that is what we are invited to do, is to experience the space of the body as emptiness, because we tend to experience the body as autonomous, separate, solid, an independent entity to which we relate with a great sense of ownership, my body, my city. But truly speaking, the Buddhist will say, or Kabir, it is empty of such attributes. It is but one node in Indra's net. It is arising codependently, being born in every moment and also dying in every moment. And which is why in this recognition of emptiness, of autonomous, independent existence, in this recognition of emptiness is a fullness, a connected to everythingness. And that is why in this city, the cosmos, fractal realities unfold. The ocean is in a drop, an inner pot, 9 million stars. So let me not try and speak of it. Let me just share the poems with you. Khel Brahmand ka is pind mein dekhiya, jagat ki brahmana dur bhagi, bahar bhitar ek akashvat, sushamna dori tahan ulti lagi. Pavan ko palat ke sunya mein ghar kiya, dhar mein adhar bharpur dekha, kahen kabir gurupur ki meher se, trikuti madhya didar pekha. I saw the play of the cosmos in this body. All fallacies and figments of the world are fading. One sky stretches outside and in, hanging upside down in the center, a string. My breath pulled upwards. I made a home in nothing. Emptiness flooded my body to the brim. With the grace and the wisdom of the whole, Kabir says, I got a vision where those three peaks rise within. And he also says, Boond padi samund mein jaane hai sab koi, samund samana boond mein jaane birla koi. A drop falls in the ocean, everyone agrees. The ocean held in the drop, a rare one sees. And so I want to end now with an image of a city that comes frequently in Kabir's poems, to which we are constantly invited, which is Amrapur, the city of eternity or timelessness. And we tend to understand Amar is as that which cannot die, that which is everlasting. But as I learnt recently from a scholar, Ravi Ravindraji, the eternal is distinct from the everlasting. The everlasting is still positioned in the idea of linear time, where we want something that we have to last forever. Whereas the eternal or the timeless dimension happens when we step off the conveyor belt of linear time. And in Amrapur then, time begins to play games with us. So Kabir says, sabse pehle hum janmya, piche bada bhai. Dhoom dham se pitare janmya, sabse piche mai. To begin with, I was born, and then my elder brother. With pomp and show, my father was born, and last of all, my mother. So, I don't know how you respond to these poems, but momentarily, to me, these poems unshackle us from being tied to the past and the future. And then for a brief moment, like we glimpsed the groundlessness in Kabir's City of the Sky, we glimpse a moment of timelessness, a dimension beyond linear time. And the only gateway to that dimension is right here, in this moment, in the now. So Kabir says, had chhadi behad gaya, hua nirantar vas, kamal ik phula phool bin, ko nirkhe nij das. I leave the small, leap into the vast, find home in a ceaseless now. A lotus blooms, no flower is seen. I sit back and say, wow. And it is in this wow, or you could say vah, that are held all the possibilities of this Kaya Nagari, this Ajab Sheher, where really, where truly love becomes possible.
जब शहर में आ जा रहे हम सब भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई यहाँ सिरगुण सेज बिछाई नीना रंग महल में अजब शहर में आ जा रहे हम सब भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई सिरगुण सेज बिछाई अरे हारे भाई देवालिया में देव नाही झालर कूटे गरज कसी अरे हारे भाई जब शहर में आ जा रहे हंसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई हाँ 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 सिरगुण सेज बिछाई रंग महल में अजब शहर में आ जा रहे हंसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई हाँ 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 सिरगुण सेज जब शहर में आ जा रहे हंसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई ओ हो 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 सिरगुण सेज जब शहर में आ जा रहे हंसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई ओ हो सिरगुण सेज बिछाई ना रंग महल में अजब शहर में आ जा रहे हंसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सेज बिछाई सिरगुण सेज बिछाई Thank you. अजब शहर में आ जा रे हमसा भाई निर्गुण राजा पे सिरगुण सहज बिछाई सिरगुण सहज बिछाई सिरगुण सहज बिछाई ओ हो सिरगुण सहज